Yes, welcome. Welcome to this inaugural lecture by our new professor of software engineering, Thomas Hildebrandt. My name is Jørgen Bansler. I'm a professor here at the computer science department. And it's a great pleasure for me to introduce Thomas. Of course, Thomas is not very old, but still he has a long and very impressive CV. Thomas holds a PhD in computer science from Aarhus University. Then after his PhD, he moved to Copenhagen and joined the newly established IT University, which is now just across the street here. And you have spent 18 years at ITU. And you have contributed significantly to the development of research, of course, but also teaching and outreach at the ITU. I just mention a few things. You have been head of the graduate program for internet and software technologies, director of the PhD school, FIRST. FIRST stands for, I have to read this, Foundations for Innovative Research-Based Software Technologies. You've also been a facilitator in two innovation networks, Infinite and the Copenhagen FinTech. And then last but not least, of course, you've been principal investigator of a number of large externally funded research projects, often carried out in close collaboration with the industry. More recently, you have been appointed as co-chair of the International Conference on Innovations in Software Engineering in India next year. And more locally, you have joined the new Research Center for Law and Digitalization at the University of Aarhus as a member of their advisory board. And then I have some breaking news. You have also been appointed as the head of a new research section here at the Computer Science Department. It doesn't really have a title yet, but the working title is Software, Data, and Information Systems Engineering. So as you can see, it's one thing you can say about Thomas is that he's not lazy. And I've been working together with Thomas now for 4 years, and I can also attest for that. What I also have learned is that what characterizes Thomas is that he is not just an excellent and very ambitious researcher, but also that he is a broad-minded and compassionate person who can inspire others with imaginative ideas. And I think this is reflected in the fact that you often act as a boundary spanner. You act as a boundary spanner between academia and industry, for instance. You have had close collaboration with many private companies. You have even been instrumental in creating a new company recently, but also you have also been a boundary spanner between, you can say, the very formal and mathematical fields of computer science and the more human-centered fields such as computer-supported cooperative work, which is my own field. And I would say that open-minded people like Thomas, they are very valuable assets for any university department. And we are very lucky that Thomas now has decided to join us here at DIKU. So please welcome Thomas, and Thomas, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Jørgen, for the very kind words. So it's a great pleasure that I stand here today. giving this lecture at Copenhagen University, just 500 meters from my former university, IT University of Copenhagen. And I owe a lot of thanks to my family, and a lot of my former colleagues, and also people I've been collaborating with during the time from industry and university. And yeah, so they have shown a lot of trust in me and what I could do during my first 45 years, and that's of course important, So that's if you look at a CV like Jørgen kind of looked at, it may look like a very straight path, right? But of course, people who know research know that there's a lot of retries and also walking in the wrong direction for a while before you actually reach there. And you never know actually if you ever reach there, right? And another point is that, of course, it's not supposed to end here. So that's just where the picture ends. There's hopefully almost as long a period after that. So I owe a lot of thanks to family and colleagues for trusting me for the first 45 years. So, what is the topic of today? Well, it is about how you bridge from doing something very formal, mathematical models. I did something called category theory, which is kind of something very few people appreciated back then. It was very mathematical, but you could go to conferences and then find your own peer group and then have a good time. And then I moved to ITU and got this responsibility, again by Henrik Reier Barnardsen, who trusted me, and Peter Sestoff, who trusted me to be head of a graduate program for internet technology as a very young researcher, and that forced me to employ people, get new teachers in from industry, and start to collaborate with industry. So I slowly turned from this very mathematical guy into someone who talked to industry almost every day, and that led us to this year, where we actually had a spawn-off company called DCR Solutions. I'm actually a member of the board of the company, but I'm not otherwise involved in the company. But it's based on research that ties slots. And Rao, are the key PhD students contributing to this new notation. And I have to show you a bit more about that later in the talk. So my work has always been about describing processes. And processes can be something inside a computer, but it has also moved from being inside a computer to being even more outside the computer in my research. So it's about work processes now, and how people collaborate at a workplace, but also how we interact with computers. So if we book a travel, we follow a process, and that may change as we find new options. But that's kind of one of the simple processes, because booking a travel is not really safety critical. It shouldn't be. But then digitalization moves forward, and then we also have processes for getting new loans. If you want to buy a house, well, then it's actually important that we can meet the criteria for getting this loan. And it's also important for the bank that they give the right advice, because if they don't do that, it's actually illegal what they're doing. So if they don't inform me that this is very risky business, I can sue them afterwards. And then it moves on. So we have seen examples that payments of taxes is a process that is apparently very difficult to get right. So the Danish government has lost a lot of tax money because it didn't get this IT system correct. And when we then get to digitalization of processes at our hospitals, well, then it becomes our lives and our health that is at stake. So this is not just important that these processes are correct, but also that the humans interacting with the computers and stuff understand what is going on with these processes. And lately, in the new project I have started half a year ago, we then look at processes inside municipalities, in particular in the family departments in municipalities and in job centers. And these are also kind of very critical processes, because it's often people who have special needs getting social benefits or trying to get back into the job market. So they are really people who are not always having a lot of extra energy to find out the route through the process themselves. So they need some trust in the system, that the system actually wants to help them. And it's not just citizens asking for this. Sometimes citizens actually ask not to be part of this. But the industry really wants to push this because they have a lot of interesting three-letter acronyms, right? So they have business process management systems. They have robotic process automation. And they also have now AI, artificial intelligence, and predictive monitoring, and a lot of cool technology they want to sell to us. And we have McKinsey in collaboration with researchers making reports stating that we could automate 27% of all the tasks in the public sector. We also have now for many years a national digitalization strategy, making it clear that this is digitalization is something that the government really wants. And it's mandatory to communicate with the public sector by digital means. And most recently, we now have a government that again tries to say, well, we can cut down our law, but now the motivation is not just simpler law, but also that it should be simpler to put into the IT systems. And if I had made a claim like this when I made a grant proposal, it would surely have been rejected. But politicians make them boldly when they make these reports, that we can save 7.5 billion, million work hours and 1 billion Danish kroner already in 2020 if we make simpler laws. Of course, there's no hint of how they came up with this number, but it looks very good, right? What is scary is that I gave one of the keynotes at the yearly conference for public digitalization in Aarhus recently. And what is scary is that a lot of the talks were about how people making the computer systems are now dictating how the law should look like. And if it's just about making something stupid good, because then it can be implemented, then it's fine. But if it actually happens outside the democratic control, that people are allowed to change the law and change criteria for how you make decisions, then it becomes, I think, a scary business, because then we have not anymore, it's no longer the lawyers or the citizens who are controlling what the law should look like, but actually the people implementing IT systems. And what I think is a warning sign here is that they do it based on what they know of what IT systems are able to do right now. But actually, we as researchers know that we could make better IT systems. So we could actually make IT systems that could cope with some of the complexity in the law. And that's one of the take-home messages of today. So it's not a new idea to make this automated office work. If you go back to the 70s, they were making drawings like this by hand and talked about office information systems and also office automation. And it had a lot of promises, but the systems they made were too rigid. When they turned these diagrams into code, it was often difficult to understand what the code actually meant, and was very difficult to adapt it. And because there was a lot of manual transformations, it was also difficult to reuse processes in other areas. So in the 90s, we had a new way because we had better technology. So now we actually had a lot of IT systems that were available on the internet. So now we could start to reuse IT systems. We could connect to the CPR register and do stuff that started to make sense now to digitalize work processes. And we also had better screens, so we could make these diagrams on the screen, not on paper, and then we could easily share them digitally. In the zeros, we then had new standards, so actually people agreed on how to make these descriptions. That was also a big step forward, because now you could in principle take a process description made for one tool and move it to another tool and then hope that it runs like it. But Tim, who's sitting over there, found out in his master's thesis that, well, that was nice words, but in practice people actually interpreted these specifications slightly differently, so you could not move diagrams from one system to another, even though it was supposed to follow the standard. Another thing is that the technology moved also, so now we had mobile phones, mobile computers, and these notations, ways of describing business processes, they could not handle that people were now changing context. And they started to expect that the computer knew whether they were in the supermarket or at work, because, I mean, it has a GPS, maybe not all that, but it came, and we expected more of the computers. But these description tools we had could not describe that a process changed its behavior suddenly when I moved into a new building. So then we had people realizing that these diagrams were really not fit for knowledge work, casework. So what happened was that people started to think in standardization to make case management notations instead of business process notations. And then of course everyone talks about big data, and that's the next thing. Adding complexity here is that we are now not satisfied with processes where we hard code the rules for when to turn right or left. No, we want to exploit the historical data to find out which direction the process should take. And that adds a lot of new complexity. And also new demands for making it transparent. Why did this process say no? Why couldn't I get the loan? Why do I get this treatment and not that treatment? It's not enough just to say the computer says no. We need transparency. And then if people have been following the news, there are a lot of issues with trust, that if we cannot figure out how the systems decide for us, then we start not trusting the system, we may not give them our data anymore, and then we lose a lot of opportunities to using the systems for good, if people start holding back data. So there's a lot of challenges. So the question here is, if we will get this future strong and secure digital Denmark, well, my vision is that we can do it. I'm not sure about in the 20s, but that's at least my personal aim, that we should move toward something stronger and more secure. But it requires a lot of research and education and transfer of knowledge back and forth between industry and research. And not least, between the users out there that actually use IT systems. So, why do I talk about all this being rigid and understandable and adaptable? Well, if you look at the diagrams, they didn't change a lot actually over the 40, 50 years. They become a bit more stylized because now they're made on computers. But we still draw these flow diagrams that takes us from the start to an end. And then there are some places where we can branch and turn left or right. And my colleagues in the area of computer support cognitive work already in the 80s realized that this was really not good for office work at all, because it automated a fiction. It automated something that people were ready to agree that, okay, this is how we work. But when you then went into practice, there were a lot of exceptions or need for skipping activities or redoing activities that was not captured by these diagrams. So one of the key researchers in the new wave of business process management research and IT systems for business process management. Bill van der Aas stated in this paper on process-aware information systems that we still lack good standards for business process modeling, and the workflow management systems we have today are still too rigid. That was 10 years ago, but it's still true. We are trying to join with KMD, so we have a new guest for KMD here to make this this better. So the challenges we are facing is, or that I've been facing during the last 20 years of research, is, well, one is that it's difficult to describe that processes are not fixed at one location. We are actually have processes that should change behavior depending on where we are. So that's the issue about context dependency and mobility. Then we have extremely little support for formal verification of these processes. And of course, if it's just a travel application, if you are going on a summer holiday, it may be okay that something goes wrong, and we at least if we find out before summer. But if it's our treatment or our bank loan or our employment at a university, then we really want, if not the contract, then we want the money coming in. And that's scary because these systems are kind of complex, and they are managing processes that are collaborations between a lot of different other IT systems and people, and they don't necessarily do what we expect them to do. So it's pretty scary that we don't get a formal proof that these systems actually do what people claim they do. Then they still follow this idea that we can describe the process and then run it. But if we do that, then we only describe what we can anticipate when we sit and program. And that's not how life is, usually. Even if you bring in two doctors or maybe 50 doctors, they don't know exactly how life is. They may even not know all the ways people can be treated in and some people then say, well, this is good because then we can make it more streamlined. But reality shows that there is actually a reason often that something is done differently. And therefore we need a way to get more users involved than just the four people or the 50 people who were involved when we made the system. We need to have people involved continuously after the system is in use and forever, as long as we use the system. If we try to get everything in from the start in the program, we get a spaghetti diagram, and you can imagine how a spaghetti diagram looks like. It's tangled and difficult to understand. And then there's a fundamental gap between, on one hand, the law, how we describe what is legal, what people should do, and then how we describe processes. And as long as we have rules being more declarative, saying you should remember to do this before you do that, or if you do this, then within 7 days you should do that. That's a declarative specification giving logical rules. But on the other hand, we have systems where we implement a flow. Then we have to somehow manually trace the flows and find out, well, do they fulfill all these rules? And that's kind of almost an impossible task. At least when we don't have a formal way of describing these flows. So, these challenges kept me busy for 20 years. I did also some small studies jointly with industry where we looked at what they did in practice, and this was supported by the innovation network Infinite, who funded these small mini projects where you could have 3 to 6 months case study where you had companies and then also universities involved. And we looked at this repository of the workflows called Arbejdsgangsbanken, and it was really an expensive attempt where a lot of people worked hard and made a lot of nice diagrams in a drawing tool where they were describing would a legally compliant workflow in a job center or in a municipality or elsewhere look like? And they interviewed the caseworkers, they looked at the law and made sure that it was compliant. So they had a long list of paragraphs from the law next to each diagram. So what we realized also when we were having this study in 2010, that while we were looking at the diagram at this meeting, and it was just the first diagram we took up off the shelf, it was wrong, because the law already changed. So instead of splitting people up in these, it was actually five groups of unemployment, so from one to five, it already changed to three. And there were no easy way of changing all these diagrams from having these five different ways of doing stuff to only three. So what happened was that 3 years later, or less than 3 years later, there was this message, and sorry because it's in Danish, but it came on the webpage that now it will no longer be updated. And before that, there had been a continuous stream of, oh, now we're updating this, and don't touch this because it's not compliant, until they gave up. So January 1st, they had to throw the towel in the ring and say, well, we cannot guarantee anything more. You can use it for inspiration. We spent a lot of work doing it, but we cannot guarantee that it's compliant. And sadly, we have seen this happening also in Germany, and they're also now trying to do it in Switzerland. And yeah, as long as we use these flowcharts in a drawing tool, it's very difficult to do anything, because you cannot verify a drawing in any way. I mean, it's not even formally precise what it means, this drawing. It's agreement between people. So yeah. So in these many years, kind of the first half of my research career, I was more focused on the mathematical models of how to make them the more expressive. And in particular, we looked at the mobile computing and mobile processes. So how could we describe that processes moved around, just like we carry our phone around or iPad around, and then make it context dependent what this process should do. So there was a lot of great guys. So some of them are here today. I think actually Hugo is the one here today on that list. Yeah. The rest have legal excuses Friday afternoon. If you have family or you are living in the US or in China, then it's okay. Of course, we made a lot of publications. That's also part of the researcher's life. And this is just some of them. And it was kind of a mixture of very, very cool mathematical models, where we could move the frontier of what you could describe in the mathematical models. We were even collaborating with Turing Award winner Robin Milner, who made this biographical reactive systems, who was a really, really powerful mathematical tool where you could define new languages. Formal languages more easily. And we made a model checker for these bigraphs. Annoyingly, when you type bigraphs, it often became biographs by the spell checker. So that was a common mistake, but I didn't do it here. So we had these results, so we made it actually new techniques for reasoning about when two processes were actually doing the same thing, even though they were looking very differently. And that was done with Mikkel, my first PhD student, and then we moved on with these bigraphical reactive systems and made model checkers and tools where you could verify any language you made in this bigraph notation. Then we moved on and said, well, we could take this business process language that practitioners in Microsoft used back then in Microsoft Development Center in north of Copenhagen. So they described the business processes using BPEL, Business Process Execution Language. It was a horrible language, also based on flowcharts, but in XML, and it had no formal semantics. So we said, we give it a formal semantics so we can describe actually what it means. And then we had the finance crisis, so they fired the entire mobile team in Microsoft Development Center Copenhagen, 40 people.
moved on to better jobs. But we still had a formal semantics. But the problem with these formal semantics are that the mathematics were almost too powerful, right? So it took a lot of work to understand what was going on with this mathematics. So asking industry to use it, well, it didn't happen. So I haven't seen industry using any of these tools yet. It's really nice, and it moved my understanding and a lot of researchers' understanding of how to describe mobile processes, but it was not applied in industry. So then I actually moved to my second stage, where of course I carried on still doing formal models, but I also met a very interesting company. I don't know, Core. No, he's not here, but maybe he will come later. So there was a very interesting company called Result Maker, and they had another idea. So they wanted to describe processes by rules instead of flows. And they had something called the process matrix, and it was before the movie Matrix. And it was a spreadsheet, and they described, instead of describing the route, they said, okay, before this action, this activity, before you get information from this patient, you have to get the consent. So they had these rules described. But their problem was that when this matrix grew and became big, they could not explain it. And they could, when they say, this is the maternity leave law, people looked at them and say, right, we don't trust you. So they came to us and said, well, we have this very nice way of making flexible, more flexible processes, but we cannot really convince people that this is what they want, what they ask for. So can we do something here? And then we had a project called TrustCare, jointly with Fritz and Andre and Jakob Barbaram, where we said, well, we can do formal models for adaptable computing based on this idea. And reach out to other areas of, Carsten, you were also part of it. So we reached out to other areas of this, it's a long ago, and say, could we formalize what they're doing in this resulting company? And maybe even do it better, because then we could come up with tools for convincing people that this is the right stuff. And we came up, based on this, we actually came up with a cleaning up what they did, and this is where we made this DCR graphs formal notation, which is a rule-based way of describing a business processes. Result Maker, they said, well, it's really cool what you did, but we cannot afford changing our system, so move ahead, go out, save the world, but we keep what we have. But then finally, I met this other company, Xformatics, Morten Makar. So he was a former DIKU computer scientist, and he knew this was really cool. And he had a more flexible IT system for case management, where he didn't have legacy. He could take what we had and implement it. So what he did was to say, well, I can do this. So he hired Thijs as an industrial PC. This is one of the examples where we had to try a number of times because we had to know exactly what to write to get the money from the industrial PSC. But we got the money, and then Morten actually helped us trying this out in practice and ending up with something that we are now selling licenses to and have a commercial tool. And then recently KMD, so Uwe is here and Jesper is also here somewhere, yeah. KMD Workshop, which is formerly Scancure, and they have also been following our activities for many years. They said, okay, now it's kind of mature, so we use your engine and then we offer this flexibility to all the users in Denmark who use Workshop, which is a widely used case management system in the Danish government. And funny enough, I think one of the first customers is Aarhus University, where I took my PhD, and it will be the grant research, I mean, the grant application administration. So it's a bit circular, but it will also come out and help other places, I'm sure. And informatics, of course, is also selling the system, so they are putting in this in other companies. But of course, it was a big move that the KMD decided to say, well, now we also use this. So we also applied it in not just case management, but also in an interesting short project on security. So we said, well, another important process where a lot of people collaborate and there's a lot of unknowns is when there is some emergency accident in the public transport. So we teamed up with Banedanmark and the Danish state railways and modeled their plans for what to do if there was a major disaster at the Great Belt Bridge. And that's a pretty complex thing. And then we had Metropol College in Copenhagen also in the project. So they had students doing risk management courses, and they used this tool for simulating a virtual accident. And having a way where you could actually describe this complex process in an understandable way, and then simulated afterwards, actually helped the students playing out scenarios in a more easy way. It also showed some limitations of the technology, but it helped us make a better system. So then we moved on and joined a new project with Jørgen as one of the principal investigators, I mean the main principal investigator, and me and Karl Schmidt and Klaus Brug Jessen Erling Hav, yeah, and a lot of good postdocs joining in, and Håkon Norman as my PC, who's there, where we had this picture that we could again take a step back and look at the foundational models for cooperative work, and joining the studies of computer-supported work in field studies with studies of mathematical models. So we have foundation funded that we could again take a step back and see, okay, what are the foundational theories of cooperative work and mathematical models. So we moved to frontier a bit, and Håkon did a really cool work just moving the frontier again of what can you do with these mathematical models. So I should keep an eye on the time. Well, I still have some, there will be time for some questions. So the main results here, I mean, of course, I'm very happy that we actually managed to move from just having math, which is nice, but just nice, and no one out there use it, to actually math that is used, because now we have a formal declarative process notation which is actually used in practice, and we can start building tools that can reason about the connection between the law and the workflows we have out there. Then we moved the frontier for the mathematical models as well. Now other researchers from Imperial College and elsewhere see that this is relevant for reversible computing, with computing where you're not just always moving forward, but sometimes you backtrack and move backwards, and this is an area where we can apply these new formal models that Håkon did in his PhD. And then finally, we applied this to the general data protection regulation because people may have heard that in 1.5 months we have a new European regulation that is going to be enforced on every company that has European citizens as customers. So if they collect personal information or any information that can be referred back to an individual, they have to comply to much stricter rules and also pay much higher fines if they break them. So we studied how could we, from the business processes, extract the purpose of collecting the data. Because this is an explicit requirement that if you give personal data to a company, you should first be told what is the exact purpose of this data is going to be used for, and then the company should somehow prove that they only use it for that purpose. And at any point, if I say, well, I don't want to give this consent anymore, they should delete the data or make it anonymized. That's of course interesting, because in practice a business process may actually be very costly to just interrupt. If the travel company already booked half of the flight and the hotel, and I said, now you're not allowed to use my personal data anymore, well, here's an area where the law needs practice, where you need to be able to describe, and then there are some compensating actions that should come into play. But the interesting part here is that this was also my first experience of meeting up with a patent officer and then writing a patent application, which is completely different from a research paper. It was very fun. So he was a patent officer working with Apple, so he had also some cool anecdotes. But we don't know if this will be anything. We are not even sure that we can use the patent, but what we know is that if this flies, then we have some at least the first foot on something very that will be very relevant for kind of any company dealing with the persons, and most companies deal with persons. So that could be fun. So since I have the time, and you are here, and you are too polite to just walk away, I would like to show just a brief idea of what is this declarative stuff we're talking about. So we call it scenario-driven declarative digitalization. And the idea is that we actually don't want to make these diagrams, right? Because we cannot maintain them. History tells us that we cannot maintain them. So we take a step back, and then we only describe the boxes, but not the flows. And then we cycle. That is a main route, saying we find who are playing in this process, the roles, what are the activities, and what is the data that we manipulate. But then we quickly move on to scenarios, just like when we made IT systems in the old days, say, okay, there are some happy paths, there are also some exceptional paths, and then there are some unhappy paths we want to rule out, and we describe them. And here we use interviews and post-it notes and role-playing and simulations. And from that, we can then start to put constraints on. We don't draw the diagram, but we put constraints to say, okay, if you want this route, but you do not want that route, which rule is it is hidden behind this behavior? Well, it could be that someone say you should not be allowed to send out this admission card for Copenhagen University before I have accepted my contract. So the rule is really that sending out admission card should wait until we have accepted for the contract. This should not happen right after, it should just wait. So we can add this route. And then we can go back and see, rerun the scenarios and see, can we still do all the happy paths? And have we ruled out some of the unhappy paths? And the whole point here is that since we never go to that path, we can put this into the IT system right away, we can start using it for the case management, and then people, when they discover that something was possible that shouldn't be possible, they can add new rules. When they discover that something is too strict, they can remove rules. And then we get a much more flexible system. And we have seen this in practice where a grant, a funding agency used this system, and they start a funding round where people send in 200 applications, and then they realize, oh, we forgot a rule. We forgot that if the granted project owner, he changes his bank account or her bank account after having received the grant, we should have a lawyer that checks that this is the right person still before we make the next payment. And in a normal system, in the old days, we had to shut down the system and change the code and get the data again and hope it works. But here we could just add two extra activities and a new rule. So that was really a nice example. And then we could actually also show that we could prove that we could still reach the end of the process. So it was actually a safe change. So what we did with Exomatics is that instead of you using post-it notes, which is a very nice thing for getting people to talk to each other, but it's very poor for keeping documentation because they fall off and you don't remember which one was in which paper, Then Xmatics spent money on making digital support for this hosted tool. So now people can, and this is what they, I gave a course yesterday in KL-huset, some 100 meters over here, for 30 people from different municipalities of all over Denmark, who had a lot of fun putting these post-it notes first on paper, but then they saw how they could do it digitally. And then when you have enough activities, you change to the simulation tool, and then you can make your happy paths and your unhappy paths and your neutral paths and save them. And once you have done that, you probably discover that you missed some activities, so you go back and add some new activities and see if you can run your simulation still. Then you take the step and say, okay, you put in rules, and this is where you should play with the tool, and I will, and you can do it. The URL is up there, desiregraph.com, and it's free to try. But here you can put an orange arrow saying that there's a condition. You have to send the contract before you can accept or reject it. That makes sense. We have accept an orange one saying you must accept the contract before everything is done in the FM department. So now we have made FM wait until we have accepted the contract. Which actually would have been annoying at Copenhagen University because the country was a bit delayed. So it was really nice to be able to get an office and get a PC, and then Christian helped me with the PC and the phone before all the contract thing was in order, right? So sometimes this rule is not the right thing, but then you would discover. So that's and the point here is that it's more than a drawing tool. It has a formal model behind it. It is simple enough so people from 30 different municipalities could just, after a 2 hours introduction, they could use it themselves and model their own workflows. And then Sydjurs municipality, they followed a single talk I gave for 1 hour. Then they went home and made their own new employee process, and it was very complex. In the municipality, they have these 40 IT systems, and you have to register a new employee in 5 of them at least, and it gets very complex. And they actually discovered they had problems with their admission card, because it was possible to get an admission card before an employee had accepted, and that gave them access to some IT systems where they could actually access some data they were not allowed to access before the contract. So they could actually spot problems with their workflow. So Xformatics thinks or believe that this is really cool. So they already used a lot of money on this, because an industrial PhD is only paid 1/3, and the rest is paid by the company. And after Thijs finished, they paid Søren Lebois, who is on holiday today, so he's not here, for a full year, continuing working on this. And now they believe it so much that they within the recent month, they made a new company called DCR Solutions, which is separate from Informatics, who is just selling this and doing this stuff. Then I gave this course, and I'm giving one again, so you can sign up. It's not very expensive. Of course, we have also documented this in a lot of publications, but the fun stuff is that you can actually go down here and play with tools. So there's the commercial tool, and then Søren also made an academic tool, so from people from academia can play with this, and also do more than you can do in the industrial tool, because we have this working procedure that we try out ideas from research papers in the academic tool, and if it works and it's stable, then we move it over to the commercial tool. So, the future. Well, we were so happy that after some attempts, we received money for ECONO, which is an acronym for Effective, Co-creative, and Compliant Adaptive Case Management for Knowledge Workers. And we are building on what we have been doing so far on flexibility and adaptability, but what we lack still is that end users really can chip in and model. So this project is putting also a strong emphasis on the computer supported codes of work, and how does these systems fit into the work practices, and how can we get people to understand these notations. So here we're really talking about bringing people who understand work practices together with people who understand technology, so we can improve both. And we can improve technology based on understanding how people work with technology. And the other way around, people who study how people work with technology, they can also bring in something else than just state of the art. But they can also say, well, but you may actually be able to do something more than what state of the art can do right now. And that fits very nicely with this new section that I was convinced to take over, which I think is really nice, trusted opportunity, because it brings together people from computer-supported codes of work and formal methods, and I think we can do really, really cool stuff. Not that all the formal method people should do computer-supported codes of work or the other way around, but they should respect each other and know how they can collaborate, and then we can do really nice stuff for the society. So, and then we are just about to hire, we have hired Annette Møller-Petersen as a PhD at ITU. We have hired Hugo Lopez, who has been out in industry and around, and now he comes back as an industrial postdoc at Exformatics and ITU. Then we have hired Håkon as a postdoc for a year. I think we have just offered a postdoc to an industrial postdoc at KMD, who will be then partly at KMD and at DIKU, working with big data. Because that's the other part of this project, is that now we have the flexibility, it becomes relevant to use data to guide people. Because now we don't have fixed rules for when to turn left or right, we can start to use data and say, okay, when should we do this next step? Just like you're driving in your car, you use data from the traffic to find out should I pick that route or another route. So could we do the same in case management? So the project covers these four research aspects, and I was also, it's also a milestone for me that Roland made a drawing in Politiken when we announced the project, because this is also a cartoonist I have been following since I was a child. And it's ironic, right? So it also shows that this is kind of an area where people have opinions. So when we come and say we can use technology to help caseworkers, well, one way to read this is that the caseworkers are just burned out. They don't care about their work anymore, and then they get this small little helper who takes over the work and find the coaching course for the unemployed person. And this is not our intention, right? And we don't believe that the caseworkers are burned out people. On the contrary, we have already, Annette already did a master's thesis field study in Sydjurs municipality, finding out how caseworkers work and how different they work. And also how different they document how they work, which is one of the problems we have to look at here. See, if we want to take data in and learn, we need somehow to make it more structured without making their work annoying, so annoying them in their work. Because if you just say they should pick between three categories when they describe a citizen, they would be really angry, because you cannot describe a citizen with these three categories that we have chosen. But we somehow need to get structure out of the way they document the work. And so there are these four areas, and the project runs for 4 years, and it has been running now for half a year, which is the kind of preparation where we did the master's project under supervision of Lars, who's sitting right there. And now we have the manning, so we can now start actually do the real research. And
here's an example that we are looking at, the Consolidation Act on Social Services. And here, these laws are about how parents get support if they have a child with disabilities or a permanent illness. Then there's a lot of complicated rules for when they are entitled to get this money. And today, it's some of it is in spreadsheets or more or less formalized what should happen, but other parts of it is in the head of the caseworker that you are lucky to get or unlucky to get, deciding how if you are within the target group or you're outside the target. So something we're looking at here is how can we support this discretionary choice of saying you can get money, you cannot get money. And then of course the complications are here that at some point the child is no longer a child, and then it continues but with a new set of laws because it becomes an adult. So yeah, so there are many good people. We have Lars, Jørgen, Naya, Marisa, and Annette working in this work package on computer supported coursework work. And then we have another work package where we have international collaboration also from Tartu University on this predictive process monitoring. And this is where we look at data to predict where people are heading, and this is also where it becomes ethically interesting, because we already have episode where municipalities are looking into data and say, well, maybe we can predict if a child gets problems at home. That's not something you want to be told as a parent, right? And it's not even clear that it's legal that they do it without asking people that they do these predictions. So we are not aiming at doing these predictions. What we are aiming at is to do statistical paths, just like you have typical paths in your GPS, and then the citizen can choose themselves if they have a case to compare this case with one of the typical paths, and then take this advice. And a very important research question here is how we make these prediction algorithms explainable, and Thijs is already having a PhD student, Christopher, who's also here, who is working on these prediction AI models and in his own project. And the key problem here is that we cannot use these algorithms to choose for a citizen if you cannot explain how this choice was made. But before we can run the prediction algorithms, then we need to turn some of the unstructured data into structured data. Because right now, a lot of the data is just simply letters or documents in document management systems, and it's very difficult to match them to anything related to the law, unless you do it manually, but then you cannot use these algorithms. So, Alec, who's there, he's going to play a key role here in actually programming some of these systems so we can try this out in practice. Then we continue the mapping of declarative processes, and Søren and Hugo already made a prototype tool jointly with the informatics on how to mark up the law text so you can relate it directly to these colored arrows in the model, so you can have traceability. And I know Fritz did related stuff in the past on this isomorphism principle between having elements, a one-to-one correspondence between elements in the law and elements in the model. And this is crucial if you want to keep it up to date. So if someone remove a paragraph or replace it with something else, you need to know which parts of the model should be replaced. And here we also collaborate with David Basin on the security aspect, because he has been doing a lot of tools so he's head of information security lab in Zurich, ETH Zurich, and has been doing a lot of stuff on the monitoring of security policies using formal models. And then finally, in the fourth work package, Barbara Weber, who's up here, is heading that, and her student Amina, and also jointly with Andrea, that I forgot to put a picture on. I should have done that. So Andrea brought in and Thijs Lars and Hayo Reyes from the Prime University in Amsterdam is looking at the understandability of all these models. So they actually put these eye tracking devices on people while they try to understand the models and see, okay, where do they look? If they don't look at the right spot, can we learn something about making this more understandable? And Barbara and her team has experience doing this before this study. So
okay.
So this is where we are going, and now I'm close to the end, so you can. So we are aiming at this vision of a knowledge workflow GPS. So it's not a roadmap, but it's the law that gives us the map, and combined with the local practices and policies. We empower the end users to actually be able to maintain and understand this. And we use data analytics also jointly with a company called Maps in Italy. So this is a company who do event processing within municipalities and hospitals in Italy and to improve business processes. And down there they call the local government systems for corruption control systems. We don't do that here. But they have a lot of experience in that, but of course before we can move data to maps in Italy, we have to know exactly what is the sensitive data and what are the laws governing these sensitive data, because otherwise we cannot get maps. Then we have Carl Kaden, which is the advisor in law matters to the government, well, so far at least, and they are in the project helping us with the how should we model these laws, and are they understandable by lawyers? And then we have Sydjurs Municipality and Copenhagen Municipality and Dansk Socialrådgiverforening, which is a social workers union, and also Globe Team, helping us connecting this to the press, and Mikkel is a bit, for a few months, still one of our contacts in Copenhagen Municipality. But of course, if you know something about robotics and AI, you may move to other places. So yeah, maybe we move to somewhere else now. But that's also part of a research project that people move around. Yeah. So now we have the all the participants. So this is it. Now my kids get embarrassed. But the key takeaway here is that instead of trying to adapt the humans to fit this technology that we have been doing for many years, where we say, okay, we have these flow charts, now we also have government say we have to adapt our laws to this technology. Well, we can actually try to develop some trustworthy technology that can be adapted to humans and also to the complexity we need. But this, of course, requires that we do some interdisciplinary research. yeah, and this is where I'm happy, because this is actually the goal of the new section that we start up here at Copenhagen. Yeah, that was the words I had. Thank you.
Thank you, Thomas.
We will, of course, have a reception after this, but I think we still have some time for some questions, so please. Yes?
Why did you decide to patent it?
That's a good question. Well, it was partly because David had experiences with doing patenting. With technology developed in his research group, where it became a useful ingredient in forming these companies. Because if it was just up to me, I would have said, well, also 5 years ago, I would never have said any patents, I don't do it. And it has always been the politics of Exomatics, say this is open, everyone can implement it, it's completely open what we do. Because the fact that they have been collaborating with us gave them this advantage of being ahead. But we here we said, okay, it's a new experience, and we have one of our co-inventors saying he had some use of it. So let's follow it. And it was, I think it was a very useful experience to work with this patent officer to say, how can we then describe this as a patent? But I don't know what will come out of it. We don't even know if it will be accepted. But that was the, I think that was the main drive. But we have already published the first research paper on it, so as soon as you have filed the patent, you can tell the world about what you're doing. So, yeah. And then it's up to ICU Business Development Unit also what we can do with it, because they also get a share. I'm not afraid here. I mean, it's not that we will not have IT systems compliant with the GDPR for this reason, because we have the patent. but if it becomes a patent, then people at least have to do something, refer to this patent, license this. But the entire business model around it, I will also, that's not up to me too. Comment on right now. But I'm not afraid that we will not have privacy because of this.
Mm-hmm. Any questions or comments?
Okay, good. So these process automations, maybe cases where for intra institution applications, have you considered? Institutional operations. And here's my actual question, which if you have success, how do you convince participants that the information aggregator, for example, KMD or DCR solutions, is actually sufficiently trustworthy not to actually exploit their position of having superior information? So think of it as the analogy of being a, you know, Facebook or Google, who have an information asymmetry.
So that's a good question. So of course, one thing is that they don't, the process descriptions don't need to be given to KMD or Xmatics. They can stay within the company.
I mentioned there's at least two companies.
Yeah, okay. So it is something we have been looking into. First we looked into type systems guaranteeing the interfaces between companies so they could agree on at least the protocols. But of course, trusting that the companies then actually do what they claim they do, and on the other hand, we have to, and this was part of the trust care project actually, where we were thinking of reaching out to proof carrying code. But now, more recently, Thijs and CERN has been looking into using blockchain technology to run these declarative processes on a blockchain architecture, where you cannot say you did something without actually doing it. But it has other issues, but that's, then you have to talk to Thijs at the reception, because that's, I decided not to follow that path, but there are very interesting possibilities there. Also because this way of doing it is very much event-based and distributed, so it lends itself to a very distributed way of implementing this, where I have no central process control. Ronnie?
Well, kind of, we both have this experience with interdisciplinary cooperation, and I would have a question into that a bit. So normally, do you have the interdisciplinary cooperation? Sometimes you have computer scientists and saying, oh, we have the social scientists, they are kind of making sure that our technology gets used by the people. Or you have the social scientists and say, oh, this is our computer scientists who are doing actually the fancy stuff that we design, they are implementing it. So what is your take on interdisciplinary cooperation?
I think that that would not really make anything, that would not make a big improvement. So this is why we go together and actually also join each other. So the technical people also join into some of the field studies and see what is actually going on here. And the other way around, the CSW researchers are not just handing over the descriptions of the work practices to, for us to implement, but they actually also learn about what is it that we believe we can do more than standardizing systems. So we have to learn about each other's how we can how we do our research in order to do more than just hand over the token to someone else. So this is what we have been doing through several years now, and I think it works well.
Sure.